First read is your briefing from Meet the Press and the NBC political unit on the day's most important political stories and why they matter. Washington. The Trump era has produced a familiar pattern. The president says something, his aides walk it back, and then the president says something again. Wash, rinse, repeat. We saw two examples of this Wednesday, on the thorny subjects of the Mueller probe and immigration. Trump's statement, he's willing to speak, under oath, to special counsel Mueller, I'm looking forward to it, actually, Trump told reporters when asked if he would talk to Mueller, per NBC's Darton Oro Clark. I would love to do that. He'd like to do it as soon as possible. Trump aide walked back, that's still being negotiated, in a phone interview after Trump's impromptu comments. White House special counsel Ty Cobb qualified the president's remarks, saying Trump was willing to testify under oath, subject to the terms being negotiated by his personal counsel. Cobb said those terms were still being negotiated. Trump's statement, he's open to a path to citizenship for Dreamers, over a period of 10 to 12 years, Mr. Trump said, somebody does a great job, they work hard, that gives incentive to do a great job. Whatever they're doing, if they do a great job, I think it's a nice thing to have the incentive of, after a period of years, being able to become a citizen. The New York Times writes, Trump aide walk back, fire drill. Within hours, Mr. Trump's off-the-cuff comments to reporters seemed, again, to suggest flexibility. But his remarks sent the White House staff scrambling in what one official called a fire drill. And if you want to see where we're headed on immigration, here was the headline from Breitbart, Immigration Shock Amnesty Don Suggests Citizenship for Illegal Aliens. It all raises the question if Trump is going to say something, and then his aides have to walk it back, what's the legitimate reason to cover his words when it comes to policy? The 2018 primary season is about to begin. We are now officially 40 days out from the first primaries of the 2018 midterms, in Texas on March 6th. And they will go on across the country for 6 months. The primaries include GOP ideological fights in Arizona and Nevada's Senate contests, a grudge match that goes all the way back to college and Indiana's GOP Senate race, crowded gubernatorial fields that could produce future Republican and Democratic stars in Florida and Ohio, and a battle between two Stacys in Georgia's Democratic gubernatorial primary. Here's a calendar of states and contests we're watching, from March through May, to clip and save March 6th, Texas, Lupe Valdez vs. Andrew White in Dem TX Gov, TX2, TX7, TX21, TX32, March 20th, Illinois, J.B. Pritzker vs. Chris Kennedy vs. Dan Biss in Dem EL Gov, IL3, IL6, IL12, May 8th, Ohio Demo Gov, including Richard Cordra, Connie Pillich and Dennis Kucinich, Mike Dewine vs. Mary Taylor in GOPO Gov, May 8th, West Virginia Republicans, Evan Jenkins vs. Patrick Morrissey vs. Don Blankenship for the right to take on Joe Manchin in WV Sen, May 8th, Indiana Republicans, Luke Messer vs. Todd Rokita vs. Mike Braun for the right to take on Joe Donnelly in Insen. Messer and Rokita, both members of Congress, were rivals back at Wabash College. May 22nd, Georgia, Stacey Abrams vs. Stacey Evans in Dem GarGov, Casey Cagle vs. Brian Kemp vs. Hunter Hill in GOP GarGov, America First vs. the rest of the world. Previewing President Trump's visit to Davos, Switzerland, at the World Economic Forum, the New York Times says that as the Trump administration cries, America first, the rest of the world is moving on, without the United States. The world marked a turning point in global trade on Tuesday, when 11 countries agreed to join the Trans-Pacific Partnership, announcing they had finalized the pacts and expected to sign a deal on March 8th in Chile. It was a remarkable moment for a beleaguered agreement that was conceived and constructed by the United States, then abandoned by Washington when Mr. Trump took office last year. More, Europe and countries including Japan and China are forging ahead with deals that do not include the United States. 35 new bilateral and regional trade pacts are under consideration around the world, according to the World Trade Organization. The United States is party to just one of them, with the European Union, and that negotiation has gone dormant. Phil Levy, a senior fellow at the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, observes, maybe there was some sort of presumption on the part of the president and his team that if the U.S. said stop, this process would come to a halt. What this shows is that's not true. The world just moves on without us. Reminder: world approval of America's leadership dropped to a low of 30%. Per Gallup last week, Gallup released a global poll showing that approval of U.S. Leadership has dropped to a low of 30%, down from 48% in the last year of Barack Obama's presidency. Here are the approval ratings of the job performance of U.S. leadership in some select foreign countries: Israel 67%, Philippines 59%, Poland 56%, Iraq 41%, and New Italy 45%, United Kingdom 33%, India 29%, France 25%, Germany 22%, Canada 20%, Australia 19%, a record low, Mexico 16%, a record low, Pakistan 14%, Russia 8%. Trump's stay at Davos. The president arrived in Switzerland earlier this morning. At 8:45 MET, he participates in a bilateral meeting with British PM Theresa May. An hour later, Trump meets with Israeli PM Netanyahu. And then at 1:40 PM ET, he has dinner with European business leaders. NBC WSJ poll 60% back marijuana legalization. Here's another finding from our recent NBC WSJ poll: 6 in 10 Americans support marijuana legalization. Per NBC's Renee Hickman, 60% of respondents supported allowing adults to buy marijuana for personal use. When NBC News and The Wall Street Journal asked the same question in 2014, that number was 55%. A broad majority of Democrats, 73%, supported legalization, as well as 64% of independents. By contrast, only 43% of Republican respondents said they supported legalization. Among voters who supported President Donald Trump in 2016, the number was even lower, at 37%. And the poll found that 73% of those ages 18-34 support legalization, while just 38% of seniors do.